Welcome to another edition of Pittsburgh Sports Line. We're in studio tonight, so you're watching us on Verizon 32 or Comcast 7, only in Bethel Park. Thanks for everybody watching the show. We've been getting a lot of great feedback as we're delivering magazines, and people are watching us all over the place. They go, they know those guys. They know Chip the Prophet Hayner. They know Smoking Jim Frazier. They know Little Z's back, Zach Brenner. And they know Al Levine, the talking machine. Thanks to John Tiger Kiger. He's on the camera. Devin Shazer in the control room. And we're about ready to start our show. Thanks to Dave Cable for getting that Sip Sports Bar show up. You got to watch that show. It'll be up tomorrow night. You'll get to see all our shows Tuesday through Saturday night, 7 o'clock to 8. Smoking Jim, tell your Monroeville people every 7 o'clock to 8, Tuesday, Wednesday.
God's country.
Thursday, Friday, and Saturday night, you can watch Pittsburgh Sports Line and then a couple other times. Boxing at 10 o'clock, Friday nights. Boxing again, 10:30 on Saturday nights. Who knows, we may be doing MMA. We just talked to Hank Hennesack. Little Z had a secret luncheon today. They were negotiating, so we'll see what comes out of that. And what we do is we start our first segment with what's on our mind, and I'm going to go to Little Z, Zach Brenner. What's on your mind?
Well, by the way,
hey, before you go there, Little Z, at the luncheon, was the ring car girl there?
No. So that figures why nobody was there. Because my Smoking Jim was absent that minute.
Speaking and now we'll start our show. He got the women
things
out of his mind here.
I got a couple things on my mind here this Tuesday evening. One of them is I'm wearing my fractured
sleeve. Oh, that's what he got going on.
From the cage. It wasn't a secret luncheon. Al Levine was invited at 12:30. I didn't have enough time to get you in Bethel Park and get to the North Shore and get back to Homestead.
I was heading out in a half an hour, so I couldn't have been there anyhow.
I know. Well,
thanks.
You missed a great lunch. Great
and discussion. Pepe's.
Great discussion.
Oh, man.
They're trying to get me to fight in the cage. I mean, you guys are going to have to stay tuned for that.
I knew there'd be heavy-duty negotiating. That Hank's good. I think he talks more than me.
No, I think Brendan talks a lot, too. But, I mean, you don't want to tell a guy with that size and that stature and that kind of record on YouTube to be quiet. So we'll proceed this evening.
Yeah, what's on your mind?
A couple things on my mind. I got to catch the Mike Tomlin press conference while I was in traffic this morning, and Coach Tomlin pretty much says the same thing week to week, every week. You know, the standard is the standard, whatever that means.
Did he say it?
No.
Because that'd be the first time this year.
My thing to Coach Tomlin is he said an interesting thing that he got called on during the press conference, that he doesn't really evaluate the young talent through the season. But then he said he's always evaluating talent. So it kind of doesn't make sense to me that he contradicted himself. He said he doesn't evaluate the young talent during the season, but he's always evaluating talent. That's what he said while I was listening in traffic.
Hold that thought. We'll revisit that.
But my thing to Kevin Colbert and the front office of the Pittsburgh Steelers is clearly you guys have dropped the ball on evaluating talent. So since Coach Tomlin brought it up and Smoking Jim is a scout, I think you guys need to give Smoking Jim a little bit more than the steak dinner that he gets every draft day, so he can get out there and get on the road and find us some better blue chip prospects in the draft. And we're going to lose a pick because of Coach Tomlin's little sidewalk sideline dance. So my thing to you guys is that going into next season, there's a bunch of players, and I just found this out too in the ride, that Lamar Woodley is a $14 million cap hit next year if you get rid of him. So you can't get rid of him, so Lamar Woodley's coming back. So there's going to be a couple players that you don't want back that are going to be back anyways. And Cowher's players are almost all gone, and they're for the most part breaking down. Heath Miller, I don't know how much he got left in the tank.
He got more. But we're going to revisit this. You're covering.
We got a lot to revisit, but the Penguins are playing too. Tonight, and I'm pretty excited about that. Marc-Andre Fleury's been playing solid and goal. Nobody wants to talk about that. We only talk about number 29 when he's, you know, stinks in the playoffs, but for the most part during the regular season.
No. We'll revisit that too. You got to revisit some videos too.
Yeah, we got a bunch of stuff to revisit here. We got some Sips talk. But
what else do you have on your list for what's on your mind?
The last thing that was on my mind regarding Coach Tomlin is just the fundamentals of coaching, just basic fundamentals, clock management. These are things that you learn in Pop Warner, high school football, college football, just basic, like, fundamental, essential things that this team just lacks. And I also feel like the offensive coordinator should be fired immediately, if not yesterday or the day before or, like, 10 games ago, because what is happening in the South Side is clearly not materializing on Sundays on the field from these guys. You know, they're clearly not on the same page. Bell was running great in the first half. He was running excellent in the first half. Why did we stop running in the second half?
We'll revisit that, too.
That's what's on my mind. We'll get back to a lot of stuff here. These guys are probably going to run out of stuff after I just said all this.
No, actually not.
They're making fun of me with my pencil.
Not a chance.
No way, buddy. Don't you worry.
Not a chance.
You're getting your feet under you again. You're getting steady. You're starting to get up to the standard that we have with the standard, because we don't know what that standard means. We have a winning team here, though. We know that. Thanks, Little Z. I appreciate it. Smoking Jim Frazier, if we can interrupt you, what's on your mind?
Thanks, Al Levine, the talking machine. And if you want the green,
got it. Give it to him.
You got to see Levine. And I tell you what, what's on my mind is if I can get to my page. Woo, a lot on my mind today, but I'll be real quick. What's on my mind is, first of all, I told everybody before, and I got to reiterate, because it's still news in Washington, D.C. Last year, they said the Coach Shanahan almost stepped down because he was tired of the owners with his lips wrapped around the butt talks of RG3. And I told everybody on draft day, I told everybody before the draft, everybody thought I was crazy, that RG3 had the mental stability of a Cordell Stewart. And you don't want that guy as your quarterback, because when times get tough, you see what's going to happen. He was a selfish guy. He's a selfish player. The players hate him. The coaches hate him. And they gave up 3 first-round draft choices to get somebody like him. And moving forward, you're not going to be able to add anything in the draft. So who made out big time is the Rams. Secondly, what's on my mind is Bruce the genius Arians. You know, Bruce Arians, all he wanted to do was play golf and coach Big Ben into the Hall of Fame, and to play golf with Ben and to be his mentor, something like Dick LeBeau. But Looney Rooney, Art Rooney II, fired Bruce Arians, and all he's been doing is sticking it to the Steelers and everybody ever since. You know, Big Ben and the Pittsburgh Steelers have not been the same since Bruce Arians left. Andrew Lucky has not been the same since Bruce Arians left Indianapolis. Wow. And right now, Bruce Arians has the Arizona Cardinals on pace right now for a Super Bowl run. If they get into the playoffs, I don't see anybody beating them. They're one of the few teams that have not peaked yet. They're playing about 50% of their capabilities right now. And right now, they're rated in the top 5 best teams in all of football. So the Pittsburgh Steelers hadn't made the playoffs since Bruce Arians left. I don't think Indianapolis is going to make the playoffs this year. And look for Arizona Cardinals to maybe give Bruce Arians another NFL Head Coach of the Year award. And that's what's on my mind.
Hey, you do realize the honey badger is out for the season, right?
No, I didn't know that.
Yeah, he got a torn MCL, ACL, LCL.
Well, we'll get back to that. He left so much stuff. You guys got that whole end of the table's just like loaded up. But now we're going to go to Chip the Prophet Hainer. He's coming off a couple predictions that he had.
Hey, first, before we go to Chip, can I just say one thing? Hey, stay tuned. Anybody that's fans, in about 10 minutes, anybody that's fans of David Dinkins, if you know David Dinkins, if you're a fan of David Dinkins, I'm going to enlighten you on some things about Dynamite David Dinkins in about 10 minutes. So stay tuned, everybody.
What he was teaser. Just kidding. Please don't change the channel. Stay with us. He didn't mean what he said. Stay with us, folks, please. I need all the ratings I can get.
I don't know. We're going to have a little blackout on that side of the table. No pun intended. Chip the Prophet Hainer, what's on your mind?
Thanks, Alan. And sorry that I missed you guys last week. You know, work
work called, and I got to pay the rent. But first thing that's on my mind, want to give a little shout out to Aaron Donald, winner of the Nagurski Award. Pittsburgh Zone.
I don't have anything else to talk about.
I told you.
Penn Hills alumni, University of Pitt. The kid's going to go high in the draft. The people over in the south side should take a look at him because we need help on the defensive line.
But they won't.
But next, okay, and I have been a huge critic of the BCS and the bowl rating system and how they gone about choosing a national champion candidates, and I think that in the last year of the BCS, with the coming of the playoffs next year, BCS finally got it right. This year we've got a title game that's actually worth watching. Florida State, no question of a doubt, this is a team that deserves to be playing for the national title, and the team that it's playing against, the Auburn Tigers, have rightfully earned their spot in the championship game. Now, I know a lot of people are critical, and they say, well, Alabama's still the best football team in the country.
They are.
Well, not so much, because
they are.
If you look back 2 weeks ago, on that Saturday, Auburn was the better team. And that's the way it boils down. But if you look at the BCS system for playoffs next year, I mean, even if the playoff system was in place, the top four teams would be the four best teams in the country. Florida State, Auburn, Michigan State, and Alabama. So, the system finally worked. I'm looking forward to the national title game. I'm really happy to see that Ohio State took a dump last week and fell out of the picture. Because if there was one team out of all the teams that were in vying for the national title, Ohio State was the least worthy of them all. And if you look at what Ohio State has done over the last few years, they've played one team in the top 15 since 2011. And since 2010, they've played one team that was ranked in the top five. They had the easiest schedule on the planet.
Why is it their fault that the Big Ten is soft?
We'll revisit that.
No, I mean, everybody's entitled to their opinion. I just don't feel that Ohio State was a worthy national championship contender. But that's what's on my mind.
I agree with that.
Thanks, Chip. You three guys were just unbelievable. Everything on my mind
left you nothing to talk
is
about.
On the table.
The honey badger you can talk about.
I don't want to talk. I don't like them. I don't like the honey badger.
He was a great college player.
There's stuff going on. Penguins. You didn't mention Penguins. Oh, we'll talk about that later on.
I did mention the Penguins. Marc-Andre Fleury.
I'm kidding. Darn, these guys catch me on that. Oh, did we talk
Pitt about
at all?
Salka.
We talk Pitt. Well, we got a boxing segment. Listen, we haven't been on the show for a while. I could talk MMA. Oh, we're going to talk about that, too. High school football. No, we'll talk about that later. You know what? I got a lot on my mind, and it's everything they talked about and more, and some opinions. So we're going to dive right into this revisitation. We got to pick Little Z. He had about seven things there. Smoke and Jim only had four.
Well, it's not called give me the one thing that's on my mind, because I always got so many things on my mind.
We're going to have let's focus on one thought here that's on your mind, and then we'll go to segments. I'm going to break it down. Next week, folks, stay tuned. We'll have another adventure here.
I promise I'll have one thing. One thought.
What one thought are you holding on your mind right
it
now?
Won't be good.
No, I'm kidding.
My one question about the Mike Tomlin press conference, and how many different ways did he use the word obviously? And how, is there a person on the planet that can use the word obviously more times in a sentence or in a conversation
Maybe
than Mike Tomlin?
Maybe Smoke and Jim could tell us who the woman reporter was that was in the room that was
He's
asking all
there.
The tough questions
He's
today on the radio. I don't really know her name, but I'll
He's
find out.
He's never there. Don't ask him that, please.
I think
please.
It might
You'll
be a Didi Kinkawala.
Maybe. She's good.
She works for the NFL.
Well, here, another thing with Tomlin here. How come he was so smart when we were winning football games? And now he's saying the same things are similar, and everybody thinks he's an idiot.
Well,
how did that happen?
I never thought his football knowledge was so great. I mean, he never really had the full resume that I would have liked. I mean, if it wasn't for the Rooney Rule, Mike Tomlin would not be the coach. Russ Grimm would be the coach of the Pittsburgh Steelers. Maybe not right now.
I absolutely disagree with you on
well,
that.
Russ Grimm
they were
had
ready
the
to
job.
Call the, they were Russ, calling yeah, the press conference.
Yeah, Russ Grimm had the job. Art Rooney the second. Was hiring Russ Grimm.
That's our man on the inside.
It was the Rooney. It was the Rooney Rule, and it was also
Dan Rooney.
It was also the owner of the Detroit Lions, Ford, who was outspoken about why the damn Rooney, the rule was named after Dan Rooney, that they really had to step
practicing.
Up.
He wasn't practicing.
Yeah, poor Russ Grimm had his suit and all. And I said the whole time, and I tell you what, I almost got kicked out of NAACP for some of my viewpoints about Mike Tomlin because...
Did you pay your dues?
You know, I'm a lifetime member.
Oh, good.
And, but the thing is, you know, when you are critical of somebody, you know, I've never said that Mike Tomlin couldn't coach. I said he's never coached. And the thing is, I said the only how that you'll have a similar situation that Mike Tomlin had if Hines Ward goes over to Korea and brings a coach back that doesn't talk English and you put him on the sideline. That's the only way. This was a guy who had 1 year, and Chip knows this as well. He had 1 year of defensive coordinator experience at a mediocre defense.
Two, because he was the secondary coach in the Tampa Bay Buccaneers.
No, he's saying as a
two.
Coordinator.
As a coordinator, yeah, Minnesota, yeah. He was secondary coach.
Yeah, Minnesota, he was the defensive coordinator.
But he was
coordinator.
Defensive coordinator for one season. They brought him in, and he's a great orator, but they brought him in. The defense was going to be, they kept all the coaches, and they kept the same system that Bill Cowher had. And Dick LeBeau ran the offense.
Bruce, the defense.
Bruce Arians ran the offense. And this was an unfamiliar system to him because he came from Tampa, too. So all he had to do was stand back and watch the Jumbotron all game. And
so you mean,
some,
what's the mic that he has there? Who's he talking to?
Because he's
see him
listening
to
music. He could be doing anything. Look goes with his outfits.
But you know what? To speak to the points about the Steelers. here's what the bottom line is with the Steelers. You know, problem with the Steelers this year isn't the coaching. I think it lies more along the lines of Kevin Colbert's draft picks and the talent that they have not brought into the team. But the reason that Steelers are falling apart, they're an old defense, and these guys are starting to slow down. And where when they were younger, they could make mistakes and recover from them. When they're making mistakes, they're out of position, and there isn't qualified people. To finish my point, Mike Tomlin's not going anywhere. Todd Haley's not going anywhere. Dick LeBeau's not going anywhere. And you know what? The Steelers are going to still be successful. But what has really surprised me a lot about the Steelers this year is the emergence of Cameron Hayward. And somebody that we were very critical of is Jason Worlds. Jason Worlds has stepped up to the plate, and he is playing an excellent linebacker right now.
Which we're going to continue this discussion right now because we're all getting fired up. I disagree with you about the Steeler coaching. They've continued to misplay things, make wrong calls, use timeouts at the wrong time, not call timeouts when you should. Mm-hmm. I'm yelling at the screen, and I rarely even talk to my screen, the TV screen, and especially before 2 minutes. When you can take a timeout, then you have the two-minute warning. Then here's what bugs me more than anything, and we're seeing it regularly over the last couple of years. You go to timeout or even between quarters, and then you have to call timeout again because they didn't communicate the play to whoever's in there. That Crazy. Is poor coaching. Mm-hmm. The players cannot play because they don't have the talent that they do. That's obvious. But if you don't put them in the right position with the play and you got Big Ben going like, what are we doing here? You just talked to him, didn't you? And all this stuff with this lovey-dovey stuff with Haley and Big Ben, there's no love affair there. He throws them under the bus if you listen to him every time. These are some of the things that I observed.
He went to his defense this morning on his segment on the
fan. If you want to speak about coaching,
There was comments that were made after the game that people said he was being critical of Haley. They were just snippets of his conversation. They were edited.
But Big Ben is very cagey in what he says. I've worked with people like him. You may not think he's throwing you under the bus, but when you listen to what he talks about other people, he ran you over twice. And he does come to his defense a little bit, but it's so weak, it's after they've already chopped him up.
But to get back to Chip's point, which is an excellent point, and I've been grading their draft a D ever since Bill Cowher left, and I told everybody then, and I will say it again, and I've said it on national radio, that Kevin Colbert, although one of the nicest guys I've ever
and
met
your
in my
friend.
Life, and as a friend of mine, is the worst GM in all of football. And I said that Bill Cowher ran the draft. He was the GM until he left. Kevin Colbert took over, and the drafts have been horrible. And I says, when Bill Cowher players begin to retire, the Pittsburgh Steelers are going to turn into what the Pittsburgh Pirates were, and Chip and everybody else can see that now. The team is old, and they haven't drafted properly. And you look at Jason Worrell. Jason Worrell's always had you. This is a kid that you've watched practice, but you went out and you drafted a guy in the first round. Of all the players we could draft in the first round, they drafted a player that, one, I don't like, and two, that now Jason Worrell is better than. So now you got to pay, you're paying two right outside linebackers because you got to re-up Jason Worrell. I don't see him getting away.
No, I don't, you know, and they'll probably put the franchise tag
and
on.
And that's going to be more money. They're going to have to overpay.
No, I think really what they need to focus on in the draft next year is on the defensive side of the ball. I mean, you know, I would not waste another draft pick on an offensive lineman. I think you could pick up an adequate enough offensive lineman off of a free agent market and not have to overpay him.
When did they ever do that? We're playing with some guys right now. I don't even know who the center is. Who's the center of the Pittsburgh Steelers?
He's white.
Cody Wallace.
Well, that's a good evaluation of talent, Coach. He's white. He's like, okay, does that make him Mike Webster? No, it doesn't mean anything.
He has sleeves on. He has sleeves.
We're talking about coaching, though. Mike Tomlin was the secondary coach in the Buccaneers. Mm-hmm. He was the defensive coordinator for the Minnesota Vikings. Mm-hmm. That secondary couldn't catch a cold right now in the South Side. Outside all day in the wintertime. It doesn't. You're the head coach, though. You're the head coach. At any given time, you could step in. You trying to tell me Cowher never stepped in if he saw something he didn't like, no matter what, even on special teams? When was the last time we had a Chidi Awoma or somebody, you know, with any kind of heart on special teams? Cowher ran that team from top to bottom, and that's the only way to do it.
Cowher power.
That's the only way. The chin wins.
I've never been a huge fan of the chin like you guys for numerous reasons. I don't want to get into them. You're in your glory right now. We got a losing team.
You can't blame him for
Neil Cowher was a good football coach.
Great.
Okay. He knew about it in advance.
Bill Cowher didn't walk on water, and he didn't part the Red Sea either. You know, he lost a lot of games. He won one championship. He should have won three or four easily. And also,
if it wasn't for his wife getting sick, he'd have about four now.
No, that's not even
he
it.
Left a
he
team.
He was almost he
left
gone.
He left a team that we could have coached.
No, he didn't, because, you know, let's not lose sight of the fact that last season he coached the Steelers were 8-8, and they had to win the 16th game to be 8-8 that year against the Bengals.
And his mind was on his wife dying.
Right, but okay, you know, but I mean,
that's so. That's what I said, if it wasn't for his wife, he lost his focus.
You got a technicality.
He would have. He'd have beat Green Bay, and he'd have won that other Super Bowl, so he'd have had at least three.
Well, and
I think
you guys are taking a lot away from game planning too. Game planning, practice,
game
coaching.
Planning?
Like I just don't see it.
What
I think Bill Cowher is still right now is a way better coach than Mike Tomlin, and it's proven. There's a body of work to go take a look at, man.
And Bill Cowher didn't mind if a couple players waked and baked. Santonio would have been one more Super Bowl. He'd have got MVP of Green Bay instead of being
all that. You know, speak to one of
those blunts were getting them in trouble, especially right in front of police officers. What's
right by the Civic
that?
Arena,
yeah.
Too.
He was slapping his women, too, and he got away with that. I guess the blunt on top of the back slap.
I think he had to pay a lot. That salary was really a negative salary. He was paying.
I wanted to speak to one more of Jim's points.
We're still revisiting. And this is the longest revisitation in history of BPT.
Whatever it takes.
Nobody wants to revisit Bruce Arians.
I'll get there.
I do.
All right. Go ahead, Jim.
You know, to speak to your point, you know, Bruce Arians is another water walker as far as Jim is concerned.
Yes, sir.
But I just want to remind you of one thing, that I don't care how good of a coach Bruce Arians is, he's never going to win a title with Carson Palmer as his quarterback.
And he's never won a title, even with Andrew Luck as his quarterback. Sometimes whenever somebody's sick.
When you say title, does the NFL Coach of the Year, isn't that a title?
No.
And also in the
That's
same
an
season, NFL Assistant Coach of the Year.
Those are
no
awards.
One will ever do that again. In the same season, he is assistant. Yeah. And
let me
coach
think
of
about
year.
It. Would I rather have a Super Bowl or would
NFL,
I rather have those two pieces of paper?
Titles. Titles.
It's got wait. Vince Lombardi's no. name on there. It.
There's see what that
award.
Is.
Award. Ain't that those a title?
Are, let me put an S at the end. Awards. Okay.
That's the
you had another one.
There's one title that matters. Vince Lombardi's name's on it.
Yep, it's awards.
Okay, thanks.
Not Hines, but they're awards.
You know? There was a coach at PNC Park that was the NL Manager of the Year. Would he not rather hold up the World Series title?
But Bruce Arians got two rings, Super Bowl rings, just from the Steelers. Just in case you guys. And not only does here's the two things Bruce Arians got. He won two Super Bowls with the Pittsburgh Steelers. And number two, the Steelers are 0-2 in terms of playoffs.
That's coach? Bruce calling.
He was 0-2 in terms of playoffs.
Wasn't he quarterback's
Steelers
coach?
Steelers are 0-2 in terms of playoffs since Bruce Arians left.
In the first one, he was the quarterback's coach, and Wisenhunt was the quarterback.
Well, one thing I know, when Santonio Holmes caught that touchdown, Bruce was calling all the plays, brother, to bring us
and
back.
Who was calling the plays when we lost Aaron Rodgers?
How about the one he dropped?
Who was calling the plays when we lost to Aaron Rodgers?
Oops. The genius. Oops, the genius. So, listen, I mean.
That's how it
And
goes.
Listen, right now as it stands, the Redskins and those draft picks that Smoke and Jim's talking about, it equates to the second pick in the draft this year. Right now, if the draft was held right now,
it's the second pick right now.
And they have three first-round picks right now, the Rams. Wow. So, you know, Coach Fisher and the Rams are.
You see how fast that little brother is from West Virginia to play for the Rams?
Tavon Austin?
Oh, my goodness, is he smoking.
Didn't we have a chance to get him?
No, he went
too high. Who heard about Moose Johnson call him Trayvon Martin?
No!
Moose Johnson on the Fox podcast called
this is from another guy that's been concussed more times than he can count.
I heard it. I heard it. It's a true story.
The only person that played for the Cowboys that was more concussed than Troy Aikman.
Most likely. Everybody's been concussed in the NFL. Look at them out there. They're all hitting, getting hit. Those things happen.
Well, what about the guys that played in leather helmets or no helmets? You know, what about those guys?
I've heard a theory that you're better off. You should not even wear a helmet. You'll be healthier. Look at rugby.
Here's the only theory.
Go play rugby.
Here's the only theory anybody needs to know. All the players are a piece of meat. They're there for our entertainment.
I know. Piece of meat. Never just come back out of piece the Coliseum.
They're the equipment, man. They're like the jock straps, the shoulder pads, the helmets. That's what they are.
Art Rooney just got me in my earpiece and said, you love that piece of meat every year at the draft.
Yeah, I love it. I love it.
He said, you don't miss it.
They hook me up.
He said, you don't miss it for the world. So.
But does anybody put a gun in somebody's head to make them play football? Does anybody put a gun to somebody's head to make them get in the ring with Mike Tyson?
Nope.
Does anybody put a gun to your
why
head?
Why do they do that?
No.
So yep. They're suing
why?
The NFL.
Yeah,
they tell me right now. I just heard on the radio, as much as I love Tony Dorsett and I love the Hawk, but they tell me
that's
right
the same
now.
Guy.
They tell me.
Just so you know. Any of you watching this?
Yeah, it's the same
that's
guy.
That's the same guy.
But they said on national radio today that they're sad because Tony Dorsett took his daughters to a golf outing or a park or something, or to a college, and he lost his way. That's what they got GPS for.
Hold it a second. Wait, I've been with Smoking Jim Frazier.
You've been driving around in circles for years. GPS or no GPS?
Hey, we did make it to boxing.
How much money does Roger Goodell get paid to be the commissioner of the NFL?
$20 million
a year, and he never put a helmet on and never got hit.
Think about how smart that is.
Yeah, but do you know how much money the National Football League generates? Probably one of the biggest things.
Whoa, I think we got a caller.
What?
I can't even get to it.
Can you get to it?
I'll try. Hello, caller. Welcome to the show.
Hello.
This is Pittsburgh Sportsline. Folks, that's a first. We got a wrong number. Oh, well. Sorry to interrupt you, fellas. I thought we had a live one. Little Z usually stages a boxer. That guy was concussed. I'm telling you. That might have been our MMA guy.
That was the guy Jason Bergman knocked out.
And he's fighting on Friday night. We didn't get to the boxing segment yet. Are we done with revisitation yet?
Well, almost. Hold on, almost. Smoke and Jim said the Arizona Cardinals are going to compete for a Super Bowl this season. Do you know the division they're in?
They're on pace, buddy.
On pace for what?
Wild card.
Super Bowl.
They're not going to get it done.
If they get in, Carolina better not.
Indy still has a legitimate chance to get in, though.
Well, they ain't making it without Bruce.
All right, I'm done.
And that was our revisitation, folks. We just set a record now of what's on our mind and revisitation. And I appreciate all the input you guys have. Hopefully you folks out there learned some more stuff about us, especially Renee at the Market District. Biggest fan here. She promotes us all the time.
Thank you, Renee.
Right up here in Bethel Park.
Please don't tune away what Smoking Jim's about to talk about.
And she's passed out magazines for me at Market District at Giant Eagle, so we appreciate that. Check out the magazines
Almost
if you can find them.
Almost 9,000 copies of that magazine are circulating
throughout
the city of Pittsburgh right now.
Wow. Thanks for all the help. Now we're going to go to another segment called Sip Sports Bar. We had a great crowd. You got to go up there, 3024 West Liberty Avenue.
Well, you got notes on that too?
15216. Hey, leave his notes alone. This isn't scripted. I'm the only one without a script anymore. What's going on?
You got cue cards.
We don't even go by that.
You got cue cards. Here, Tiger Cocker.
Can you get a close up of my cue card?
I got it turned around.
Oh, here.
Look at the lines.
Okay, see? Smoking Jim.
Awards. Thanks.
That's what my plumbing license looks like.
Sip Sports Bar, they have trivia nights. Smoking Jim is a regular on Sunday nights. I get the report when Dan's brewing up his hot coffee for him because he's always fashionably late. I get to hear how many nice people he brings to the place at Sip Sports Bar. And the models are just super models. He brought another one on the show last night. Janaea Barlow, was a hit last night. And we're going to try to do some business with the good things she does in the community there. So,
was she a track star in high school?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, she just can't catch. And it wasn't a baton where it was a relay because she said she would have dropped that too. So,
She's fast.
So you know. She definitely was. But it was a great show with great guests. We had Trapper Tom was on telling us about KSWA. We had MMA, Hank Hanisick. We had Jason the Whip Willett. We had Brutal Brennan Barrett.
Wow.
Yes.
So we had a full house there. Little Z was there with Z Time. Tuesday night is Campedi night. Shout out to the Campedis. 50 cents a slice. Smoking Jim ladies night. They got drink specials, happy hour. Everything for the ladies, and they said keep an eye out for the ladies Smoking Jim brings there. They don't know how he keeps them all at peace with each other. Thursday night is wings night. I was there last week. Great wings. A lot of good time. Smoking Jim was there. And I forget who you brought there. He brought somebody who was a regular showing up there.
Brazil.
No, Brazil's disappeared. She's actually gone. There hasn't been a sighting in like 3 months. But that's another story. Friday, they do karaoke. They have a band come in Saturday night. Go to Sip Sports Bar. Monday night is our night, Pittsburgh Sports Line. Every Monday night, come on out there. Great show, great people. We're getting a lot of great feedback on that.
How about that Christmas party at Sips?
Sips, when is that? Next Wednesday.
Is it?
You didn't even get invited. How about that?
Here's why. A little birdie told us that it's on the 18th. Was that right? Next Wednesday. Batman left the building. Chip was gone, so there were no invites. Me and Z are gone. There's no doubt. We'll be there. And that's it for Sip Sports Bar. We're going to go right now to one of my favorite segments. We better try to get this in before the show's over. Fiction and Fact from Smoking Jim's Almanac.
Hey, thanks, Al Levine. And I tell you what, this past Saturday night, I co-emceed the Willie Stargell MVP banquet with former Pittsburgh Steeler great Greg Lloyd. But we also had another great in the house.
Who?
Dynamite David Dinkins. And the first thing he came up, he said he lives in Bethel Park now. And he says he watches our show all the time. So that made me revisit when I went and watched him play in college. Tune in, everybody. Dynamite David Dinkins was 6'2", 215 pounds at Moorhead State. That made him so unique was he broke all the passing records at Moorhead State of a guy named Phil Sims.
No.
He rushed for 4,000 career yards also at Moorhead State. His senior year, these are the numbers, and I went back and looked at my draft report to get these official numbers. These are the numbers he put up as far as points. 46 points in one game, 55, 56, 63, 73. That's five games of over 40-plus points. He averaged 1,300 yards rushing per season. He passed for over 6,000 yards. And again, he shattered Phil Simms' passing records, who's borderline Hall of Fame. He bench pressed 425 pounds. He ran a 4.440. I went to watch him play one game his senior year. In the game I went to see him play, he had a pretty good game. He rushed for 220 yards and three touchdowns, and he passed for 200 yards and another four touchdowns in the same game. In my draft report, I compared him to Jim Thorpe and Paul Hornung. And here are the top four guys that I had that year in 2001 on my draft report as I conclude this. Number one player was Michael Vick. Number two player was Dynamite David Dinkins. Number three quarterback that year was a guy from Purdue named Drew Brees. And my number four quarterback that year was Mike McMahon from Rutgers, who went on to the Detroit Lions, beat out Charlie Batch, became the starting quarterback, and Charlie Batch came here. So those were my top four players, and Dynamite David Dinkins never got the opportunity to get a tryout at quarterback in the National Football League, even though he put up those kind of numbers. But keep watching. I appreciate you, my brother.
What did he play?
There you go.
Did he get drafted?
No.
Did he ever play in the NFL?
No.
Okay.
But he does watch our show. We appreciate it. Thanks, Smoking Jim Frazier. No revisitation on that, Little Z. That'll be your own segment, whatever you want to do. Now we got to go to one of my favorites. We haven't had this for a couple weeks now, Chip. I'm looking forward to Chip's trivia time.
Thank you, Alan. And, you know, being that we're in the heat of the football season and the playoffs drive, I thought I'd bring up some interesting facts about, the NFL pro football history. And I go all the way back on the first one to December the 9th, 1934. And probably a game you all remember very well.
There was a game
that was played that was called the Sneakers Game. And this was a game between the New York Giants and the Chicago Bears. And it was the NFL Championship in 1934. And what happened in that game was that the game was played at the Polo Grounds in New York City. And the temperature at game time was 6 degrees.
What?
The field was frozen solid. And in the first half, the Chicago Bears went up 13-3 on the New York Giants. And the New York Giants, their players had a hard time staying on their feet. So what they did was one of their equipment managers went to a local athletic store and bought every pair of basketball tennis shoes that he could find. And they outfitted the team with the tennis shoes, and they played the entire second half with tennis shoes. They outscored the Bears 27-0, won the NFL championship 30-13.
Wow. I like that.
And think about where they're playing the Super Bowl this year.
They might need sneakers. Now, also, I'm going to give some props out to two of the greatest running backs that played in the NFL. One was Eric Dickerson on December the 9th, 1984. He broke O.J. Simpson's single-season rushing record of over 2,000 yards and set the record, which has since been broken. But the hats off to Eric Dickerson. And also on the same date, December the 9th, in the year 2000, Emmitt Smith rushed for 150 yards in a game, which completed his 10th consecutive season of over 1,000 yards rushing, and also brought him over 15,000 yards rushing for his career. And he's one of three NFL running backs to rush for over 15,000 yards, the other two being Barry Sanders and the great sweetness, Walter Payton. Wow. Also, Pittsburghers here, we've got, always are going to have an axe to grind with the New England Patriots, especially after Spygate and the AFC Championship games we lost. Well, on December the 9th, 2007, the New England Patriots beat the Steelers in Foxborough. And this was the game, I believe, where Anthony Madison opened up his mouth. And the Patriots on that day ran their record up to 13-0. And they were the fifth team in NFL history to bring their record to 13-0 in the regular season. And if you remember, the great 85 Bears, everyone says one of the greatest teams ever, they lost their 13th game. But the reason why I bring this up, because, you know, New England was one of four or five teams that went 13-0 to start the season. But the New England Patriots own the dubious honor of being the only team in NFL history to finish with an 18-1 record, not win a championship. Now, you know what? And the last little bit of trivia I got, a little tip of our hat to Tony La Russa, Joe Torre, and Bobby Cox got elected to the Hall of Fame. The players are going to get announced January 8th, and there's 36 players whose names are eligible to be selected for the Hall of Fame this year. And I could go through the whole list. There's some people there are people on here that are never going to get elected in. But I'm going to mention the top six players, I think, that have a chance. I'm going to go with the first, the top three, which I think are the three that are going to get in. Tom Glavin, Greg Maddux, and Jack Morris. Three pitchers.
Two from the Braves.
Tom Glavin and Greg Maddux, both, I believe, 300-game winners. Jack Morris won several world championships, one with the Twins. He pitched an 11-game one-hitter.
What about Smoltz? What is Smoltz?
He's not eligible yet. You have to be retired for 5 years. And the three people that I want to give an honorable mention to that I think have an outside chance to get in, I don't think will make it, would be Mike Mussina, Lee Smith, the great fireball closer for the Chicago Cubs, and Frank Thomas. They called him the Big Hurt. He played for the Chicago White Sox. And he was one of the big home run hitters of the steroid era that never got tainted by steroid investigation.
So that's
my trivia for tonight. So look for those three.
Is
Tom
Glavin not eligible? Yeah,
he's eligible. He's never going to get in.
Oh.
Well, you want to revisit fiction and fact, and then.
But one thing that was great trivia. But the one
thanks,
thing, Eric Jeff. Dickerson still does have the record.
Yeah. Does he still?
Yeah, 21-05. He has, in my opinion, the unofficial record. The official record is actually held by Herschel Walker, 2,400 yards.
When he played for the New York Generals, right?
Yes, and that's the record that I go by. But the NFL seems to go by the Eric Dickerson record.
Ah, interesting. Just like some people with baseball. Some say if you're tainted, some say you're untainted.
He's untainted. Hank Aaron is the home run king, period. End of sentence.
And that proves my point. You know, and that's the end of
revisitation. If they police baseball properly, then we wouldn't even be in the position that we're in, because these guys that abused and cheated wouldn't.
We're
going to
talk baseball right now. Let's go. Go ahead. Z, you got the floor on baseball.
Like
I just
said,
scratched
just to go to Bud Selig's a joke, because like I said, if you properly police baseball, you know, and penalize these people for they took away all Joe Paterno's wins.
Why can't they take away? Because Bud Selig's got in baseball.
They booted Pete Rose out for life.
Well,
you're
not comparing apples to apples. Yeah. So yeah, you got the NCAA as opposed to Major League Baseball.
We're in the baseball thing. Selig should
even
be gone.
In baseball,
he made
though,
a travesty of the office.
Speaking of baseball, right now we're in the baseball's winter meetings, and all the owners are in Florida meeting together, and there was a big three-player trade that happened today. Pirates weren't involved in it. One of the guys that the Pirates have been looking at, a first baseman that played for the Angels, his name was Trumbo. He ended up going to the Arizona Diamondbacks, which I thought was kind of interesting, because I believe Paul Goldschmidt was a first baseman there, or was he the right fielder? But, that seemed like they're already stacked at that position. But there's been a lot of interest by other teams in a member of the Pirates pitching staff, a left-handed reliever named Justin Wilson. And, of course, Neil Huntington's listening to what anybody has to say see what maybe might be offered on the table. I wouldn't be too surprised to see the Pirates.
Well, we
make
need
a
some
move.
Players.
Well,
we,
you know what? And they've got their eyes on some players. And one thing I like about what the Pirates are doing, they're playing their cards close to the vest, you know? And when it's time for them to make a move, we'll know.
Well, what's A.J. Burnett going to do?
Go on.
Well, here's what the thing is with A.J. Burnett. And the Pirates have been in negotiations with him, they've been in contact with him. Repeatedly, and right now there is a quote-unquote a drop-dead date. The only people that know that are AJ, Clint Hurdle, and the Pirates management. And that day is going to be coming up soon. And, you know, they're being respectful for AJ and his wishes. And I believe that if he doesn't play for the Pirates, he's not going to play for anybody this year. So it's a matter of does he want to continue.
What if they dangle about $14 million in front of him?
Isn't that what it's rumored to be, $14 million for a season?
Well, you know, that is what they could have tendered him. I personally think that they could probably get him for less than $14 million a year. I think if they would be
the
interested.
The hometown discount, you think?
I think if they could lock him up for 2 years at, say, $22 million. You know, at about $11 million a season. Wow. He might be interested in taking that, but I don't have anything to do with that.
What was his record? Wasn't he 500?
The record didn't mean as much. They like inning eaters is what they call that.
Well, you know, what he did.
You got to have an inning eater.
What he did is, here's a guy that's going to give you 200 innings pitched a year. He's going to give you 200 strikeouts. He's probably going to give you 12 or 13 wins over a season. He's,
depending on luck, not Andrew Luck.
No,
luck.
And he's...
Is he good for the pitching staff overall to have him around, a guy like
absolutely.
That, for the young pitchers coming up?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely, because he can... See, here's a guy that over his career, over the last 10 years, has averaged 180 innings a season, and he can show these young guys what you need to do, the level of commitment it takes to be able to perform in that level, because these young guys come up, they can throw the ball 100 miles an hour, but they don't really know how to pitch. They don't know how to train to be able to last through a season. They end up getting tired at the end of the season. Now, you watch Jeff Locke coming up this year. He petered out at the end of the season. He was burned out. He was used up. They're going to put him through a training process right now where I think he'll have more stamina, be stronger, and be better prepared to make it through the season next year. And I see a turnaround happening for him.
So you see no drop-off for the Pirates going into next season?
Actually, no. I think they're going to come in with a stronger team. I think they're going to make the necessary moves. And the Pirates have got a lot of upside. I've got absolute confidence in the people that we have in our system and the people that are running the system right now.
So you wouldn't say the same thing, since we're talking about apples and oranges, about the front office of the Pittsburgh Steelers right now. Like, you wouldn't have the same confidence
system. I have confidence in the way the Steelers have run their organization and their track record, okay? Right now, they're stepping on it pretty good. There's no question about that. And you look at the fault starts from the top down. I mean, that's spade's a spade. But you know what? The players have to assume as much responsibility as the coaches.
Dan Rooney gave up his job as ambassador to Ireland to come back home, to get made fun of by celebrities taking pictures on the sideline and disrespecting our coach. That's a topic for another day.
But the Steelers, to be honest with you, if you look at the way the NFL is right now, and you look at a team like Kansas City last year, 2-14. This year, they're one of the strongest teams in the NFL. Things get turned around relatively quickly. And the Steelers, they've got some holes to fill. And I think most of the holes that they need to fill right now are on the defensive side of the ball. I think the defense is getting a little long in the tooth. And, that's what I would do in this draft. I would go defense heavy.
Well, if they're going to have a no-huddle offense, I got to agree with you. But if they get away from the no-huddle offense, we can see there's a problem there.
Mm-hmm.
So no-huddle works. Big Ben calls 99% of the plays. And what surprises me is we got no-name people, because I really don't know their names, and we've been in each game. Is that strange? We're 5-8, and we could have had a chance.
Boy, that Cowboys good.
We had a chance.
Them Cowboys players is good.
They weren't even playing.
Big Ben. That's all you need, Troy and Big Ben.
Well, we know that.
And you don't think Troy and Ryan Clark are getting a little long in the tooth?
I think, actually, to be honest with you, the Steelers ought to take the first round this coming year. They need to take another safety, because I'm absolutely certain that Ryan Clark's going to go to his broadcasting career. I don't really see Troy Polamalu coming back next year. I mean, he's going to be $11 million to keep on that defense. And,
the Steelers are loyal. They'll bring him back.
Troy's
they'll
not the same Troy
he's
Paul
getting like Ed Reed.
That was going
right
to
now.
The ball. I mean, look at him. I mean, 5 years ago, does Troy Polamalu drop that first interception that he just did? It was right in his breadbasket in the first quarter. That was a pick six, Then he's Superman, and he flies through the air and gets the ball over to
Luckily.
The pylon. Later in the game, but he just doesn't do it as consistently as he used to.
How do you lose to the Miami Dolphins coming from 80-degree weather? When they turn down in their dome to simulate our temperatures, they can only get it to 70 degrees. And they come in and they beat
but
us.
But they were only wearing their pads. That was, it was a little breezy.
Zach, it's real simple to explain. You need to learn how to tackle people, and this is a problem that goes into college football. You look at the basketball scores we see in football games. You see it in the pros all across the board, every team. People just have lost the art of tackling. I see arm tackles. I see guys running free. I mean, you know, because of the way they're changing the rules, well, guys are afraid to tackle.
Let me ask you guys this while we got your ear. Who do you think that is a veteran now on the Pittsburgh Steelers that will be gone? And who do you think some of the ones that will come back? You think, let's start off with Kiesel. You think Kiesel will be?
I think this may be Kiesel's last year.
Yeah, I think he's done.
We're starting Smith to get an Aaron back. Smith syndrome, yep. Where you get mm-hmm. the injuries. And that happens in sports.
Lack of production.
Piece of meat.
Well, at
buddy.
Least Aaron Smiths were legitimate. Yeah. Who else do you guys think will be
coming? I don't see Ryan Jeez, Clark back
you're no
next
doctor.
Year. You know, I mean, he may want to play.
Ike Taylor might be gone.
I don't see him.
Your man Ike might be gone. Why wasn't he on the top receiver? They were taking him off of the top receiver. My man Cortez Allen was covering the top receiver.
Who, Wallace?
Well, in that game, Ryan Clark hit Ike Taylor in the head, and the reason why they couldn't take him out of the game for concussion reasons is because he's already retarded. So when they were talking to him...
That's not nice. This is a disclaimer. We can't help it. He's not trying to offend other people.
And Ike Taylor couldn't be taken out of the game. Ahead. His own teammate knocked him senseless.
That's what he said.
And they all went, and then that's another thing. You know, I looked at that game. You know, Ryan Clark cracked Miami's running back in the head, concussed him, took him out of the game. Then he cracked his own teammate in the head, who had to leave the field after a couple of plays. I mean, you know, what is the NFL going to punish him for that or not? I mean, there was no flag.
Castro
thrown.
Took out Pouncey. They didn't punish him.
Yeah, but he didn't hit him in the head.
Well, he went.
It was a low block. That's supposed
knee.
To be penalized.
That's what they want to do. They want people to go low. Look I'm what kidding. Happened to Gronkowski. Tore up his ACL and MCL. You know, could possibly have ended
his career. He's a brittle guy. I don't know what you'd call him, Smoking Jim. He's
unlucky.
Brittle.
Unlucky.
Unlucky. Unlucky Gronky.
Because he's tough as they
Gronk
come.
Unlucky.
He's tough as they come.
Oh, he's as tough as nails.
Is he dancing
the No, night? I don't think he's as tough as nails because they didn't get the job done in the Super Bowl. And then he was dancing around in the nightclub.
He was tough on the floor.
Yeah.
We're covering everything, folks. I hope you enjoy the show. You can call in like that person that hung up. They didn't like the sound of our voice. I have to throw my script away. There's no more things. What's the MMA report? We got new friends with Hank Hanasek, Gladiators of the Cage. They had a great night. Their team won four matches. Some in as little as like 3 minutes, 4 minutes, 19 seconds. They were knocking people out. Jason the Whip Willett. I wouldn't believe if I met him on the street how powerful and strong the guy is. And he fought at 145. And he admitted he was at 170. And he looks like he's a 20-year-old kid.
He dropped a lot of weight for that fight, that's
definitely.
For sure.
Definitely.
And it was no setback to him either. Because sometimes they smoke a gym test. When you drop that weight, it kind of like zaps like the juice. You know, like you don't have the zip and the power and the pop when you're in a sauna, like losing all that weight.
True. But it was great to have them come up to Sips. We'll have Hank back and his crew. Get some more in-depth knowledge about
people
MMA.
People
got
to go to brutalbrendanbarrett.com. That definitely. Man is a beast.
That's my new friend. You can't shake his hand because he broke his hand.
It's getting better. It's getting better day by day.
He's going to see the orthopedic guy, and they're going to fix him up. He's going to be like the $6 million man like I talked about. We're going to be winding down the show. We only got 5 minutes to go. So
we
got to
touch on the Pens.
Yeah, that's one of the things I have. We can't get to it. Look where I...
Do the Penguins need to bring in a goon / enforcer? Because over through the years, like they've always had one.
You need one.
I don't know, you know, if that's necessarily the answer. All I know is that the Penguins now have somebody in the National Hockey League that you can wrap your arms around and hate even more so than the Philadelphia Flyers, and that's the Boston Bruins. Saturday night's game, the assault on Brooks Orpik was nothing short of criminal, and this guy Thornton, he's going to go up in front of the disciplinary commission on Friday. Right now, he's indefinitely suspended.
Would he have thought twice about it if Francois Leroux could come off the boards and come over? And
because
he wanted to fight somebody, but Brooks Orpik is not a fighter. No. So wouldn't it help to have somebody on the bench that will fight you? You want to fight?
I agree.
Go fight him.
That's traditional.
But the thing is, okay, when you're the home team, which Boston was, they get the last change, and he was sent out there to take Brooks Orpik out because Brooks Orpik took out one of their teammates.
But that's when you said
with a clean
Aaron Asham.
With a clean hand.
Or whoever you had at that point.
But, if you saw what happened, Brooks Orpik was down, face down on the ice, and this dude's pushing down on him and just punching him in the back of the head. And I don't care, that there's fighting in hockey or not. That's uncalled for. I mean, if you're going to fight, square up, man to man, and you start throwing with somebody, but you don't punch somebody in the back of the head when they're face down on the ice from behind. To me, that's cowardly. That is.
But not all hockey players are fighters.
Yeah, but hockey players don't think like that. No, that's the
not
difference.
All hockey players are fighters. And right. Brooks Orpik is a great hockey player. He's a great defenseman.
You see what James Neal did to Marshawn.
And that was wrong.
And he came out today and he admitted, he said, yeah, he goes, I could have moved my leg, but he kept his leg where it was. And he knew it was going to crock this guy in the skull, and he did it anyhow.
Well, nobody likes Marshawn anyway, so he's one of those unlikable characters.
Yeah, I know. I mean, and if somebody would have done that to Sid, we'd be up in arms.
We've had it done in the Winter Classic. We've gone through it.
But now all of a sudden, I think maybe you give the Penguins a rallying cry because the games against the Boston Bruins have been kind of pretty hard games, but now there's going
to
be that little
edge
extra
to it.
Something. It's going to be like the Steelers and the Ravens.
You know who it was good to see
and
back?
And I want to announce
Tommy
again.
Tommy Vokoun. I saw Tommy Vokoun was back in the stadium.
Right, but he's not going to be
playing
this year.
Yeah, he was wearing a suit.
He was
wearing a suit.
He looked good in the suit.
And I hope he comes back. I mean, he had a life-threatening situation coming on. And you know what? He's got young kids, 10 or 11, and you know what? He wants to be a father to his children, and I don't blame him.
He wants to be alive, first of all, and that's a life-threatening. And Fleury is playing great. He does have a couple bad times. If you check some of our videos, Z, I've mentioned about how he's playing well this season. Leave him alone. He's gained his confidence, whether he has a psychological coach or whatever they do. Who cares? He kept him in the game last night without him playing. And then, on top of it, he almost scored a goal.
He did. We saw that.
Yeah, I happened to glance up because Z was screaming. I'm deaf in my left ear because I think it's smoking Jim. Now my right ear's shot. But these guys are just great here. We were watching that at Sip Sports Bar. So it was a fun night there, and he did miss it by about a foot.
And then me and Al Levine were the last two to leave last night, and Pete in the kitchen.
Last two men standing. So that's
Is the Black Hook still at Sip?
He's gone.
Oh, he's gone.
Yeah, and the meatball hoagies. This is 2 weeks in a row I've had meatball hoagies, and they were delicious, Smoking Jim. I don't know what you're eating every 2 weeks, but I had it 2 weeks in a row, and the fries were great, too. I even thanked Pete. I call him Repeat because there was a Pete original. He's the Repeat.
I ain't have no fries this time.
What happened?
They were gone before the show started.
No, I meant in your own platter. And we're going to wrap this up, folks. Z, what's going on? Rod Salka's fighting when and where?
Out in Texas at the Alamo Dome on December 14th, this Saturday night. So I hope.
And there's a private party. We can't mention where it's at. Addison's house.
It's in Munhall. You get to Munhall, you'll be able to find it.
I'm going to Munhall because that's all lit up there. They told me about where it's at. So I'm going to try to make it to Munhall.
Yeah.
Saturday night.
It's up the road from home.
Smoking Jim, what's going on? He's the busiest man in Hollywood. No, in Pittsburgh. He's got double performances every day.
I'll be at Munhall also Saturday, and make sure you mention what's going on for Thursday, buddy.
We got Little Ease. We're doing a special 30-minute show with Jessica Lee. She honored us by saying we have a lot of energy. She likes our sports show. We're doing 30 minutes. We're going to film it. You'll see it come out later on. There'll be some jazz networking. Come on out. There's not going to be snow on Thursday. So don't be afraid like you were today. We're going to have to end this show. Sorry, Chip. We're out of time. That's Chip the Prophet Hainer, Al Levine, Talking Machine, Smoking Jim Frazier, Zach Brenner. Thanks, everybody, for watching the show. We're out of time. Thank you.